ओके गाइस, सो आज हम बात करेंगे। टुडे इन दिस वीडियो वील टॉक अबाउट द टॉपिक दैट इज ट्रेंडिंग इन कोविड पेशेंट, जिसको हम बोलते हैं म्यूकर माइकोसिस। सो बेसिकली दिस वीडियो आई एम रिकॉर्डिंग टू स्प्रेड अवेयरनेस, बिकॉज देर आर मेनी वीडियोज अवेलेबल इन यूट्यूब विच आर स्प्रेडिंग रॉन्ग इन्फॉर्मेशन रिगार्डिंग दिस फंगस। सो लेट मी स्टार्ट विद द डिस्कशन। सो दिस वीडियो विल बी हेल्पफुल बिकॉज दिस इट्स अ ट्रेंडिंग टॉपिक। इट कैन कम इन योर एपीजी एग्जाम और एफएमजी एग्जाम, और दिस वीडियो विल बी एक्सट्रीमली यूजफुल फॉर द फिजिशियंस, दोस हु आर प्रैक्टिसिंग एंड ट्रीटिंग कोविड केसेस। सो लेट मी एलैबोरेट दिस वन बाय वन इन डिटेल अबाउट दिस म्यूकर माइकोसिस। अंडरस्टैंड इफ आई से द फर्स्ट द ऑर्डर ऑफ दिस फंगस। सो अंडरस्टैंड दिस टॉपिक, द ऑर्डर ऑफ दिस फंगस इफ आई से इट इज म्यूकोरेल्स। The name of the order of this fungus is Eucorales. If I say the subphylum name, the name of subphylum name is Mucormycotona. Mucormycotina, which was formerly we call this Zygomycetes. So formerly this was called as Zygomycetes. So we have the name of order, we have the name of subphylum. Then in this subphylum, what we are having family. So there are seven families. There are seven families. Out of which, if I say out of which, most common family will be Mucoraceae. The most common family will be Mucoraceae. So most common family will be Mucoraceae. Now understand this, in this Mucoraceae family, there are many genus. In this Mucoraceae family, there are many genus. There are many genus. The two common genus that are important that you should remember, the one is called as Rhizopus or Rhizi. Rhizopus or Rhizi. And second will be Rhizopus delimar. Rhizopus delimar. So these are two common genus. So I have discussed about the taxonomy of this. So you can see the order, subphylum, family, genus. So understand this, who is at risk? If I ask you, what are the risk factors of this condition? So what are the risk factor for this mucormycosis? So understand this, risk factor, the first and the common risk factor will be uncontrolled diabetes. Uncontrolled diabetes mellitus. So understand this, COVID per se itself is not a risk factor. The associated condition that you see in COVID patient, that is either the patient is having uncontrolled diabetes mellitus or any complication of diabetes mellitus like diabetic ketoacidosis or diabetic coma. If I see the third risk factor, you will see that is a neutropenia. Neutropenic patients are susceptible to get mucormycosis. So third, I'm writing neutropenic patient. The fourth risk factor is if you are using steroid for a long term. For example, in COVID patient, we are using the dexamethasone and methylprednisolone. So steroid use. The next risk factor in my list will be steroid use. Coming to next risk factors, any condition where you see more level of free iron in the body. For example, we have a condition that is called as hemochromatosis or hemosiderosis. In that condition, we use a drug. That drug is an iron chelating agent. It is called as deferoxamine. So, increase of free iron by any mean, by deferoxamine or by any mean, it can be a risk factor for a mucormycosis. The next risk factor in my list will be any kind of solid organ transplant. Suppose a patient who is having kidney transplant or hematopoietic stem cell transplant. HSCT is hematopoietic stem cell transplant. If I say in rare cases, so it can also occur due to a cutaneous inoculation of fungus. Now this cutaneous inoculation of fungus can occur by many techniques. For example, it can occur due to, suppose, it can occur by road traffic accident. It can occur because of natural disasters. Natural disasters. It can be because of IV catheter use. It can be due to IV catheter use. So cutaneous inoculation of fungus by any mean, that is a risk factor. If I say the last risk factor in my list, that will be a therapy. That is also an antifungal drug, especially that drug we use in practice. So these two antifungal drugs I'm mentioning here, one is called as voriconazole. Voriconazole and itraconazole. Voriconazole and itraconazole. So these are the risk factors, or these are the patients who are susceptible to develop mucormycosis. So if I say clinical features, if I see the clinical feature of this disease, and clinical feature of this disease, you will see a six clinical syndrome. So generally you will see the variety of six clinical syndrome. You will see six clinical syndrome in mucormycosis. So the first syndrome, that is most common one also, we call this a rhinocerebral mucormycosis. The first will be a rhinocerebral mucormycosis. The second variant, if I say, that will be second most common, so we call this a pulmonary mucormycosis. The third thing, it will be a cutaneous variant or skin variant. So this will be a cutaneous variant. Third will be your cutaneous mucormycosis. If I see the fourth in my list, this will be a GIT variant. So I'm writing is GIT mucormycosis. The fifth variant will be a disseminated disease. Disseminated disease means which is dispersed everywhere in the body. So we call this a disseminated mucormycosis. And the last variant, we call this a miscellaneous variant. When patient is having a miscellaneous disease, so this will be a miscellaneous variant of mucormycosis. So these are six clinical entity out of this. If I say the most common variety of mucormycosis, this will be your rhinocerebral mucormycosis. And pulmonary mucormycosis, this is second most common. So if I can say, like yesterday I had a case of this disease. I thought to make a video on this topic. So understand this rhinocerebral mucormycosis, this is classically. So this was the case which I got. This rhinocerebral mucormycosis, this you will see generally in a patient who is having diabetes or decay. Diabetes or any complication of diabetes. It can be decay, it can be common. Pulmonary mucormycosis is generally associated with transplant recipient or transplanted patient. Right, any kind of transplant patient or if I say any patient who is on chemotherapy due to any cancer, for example leukemia or a lymphoma. So in chemotherapy recipient or transplant recipient, you will see pulmonary variant. So one by one I'll elaborate each of these variant of mucormycosis. So let me see the first variant which I'm having, that is called as renocerebral mucormycosis. So as I discussed, this is most common variant of mucormycosis, right? So it is especially common in diabetes patient. So especially it is commonly seen in diabetic patient and a person who is on steroid. So a person who is on steroid and diabetic, you will commonly see this rhinocerebral mucormycosis. So clinically, what type of symptom you will see in a patient? You will see the patient will develop eye pain in the eye, or a facial pain. Patient will complain initially of eye pain or facial pain. This facial pain suddenly will convert into facial numbness. Facial numbness. Right? Ultimately, the patient can develop blurry vision. There can be a blurry vision. Some patient, near about 50% of patient, they will have fever. So this time writing fever plus minus, fever is not specific. 50% patient will have fever, 50% will not have fever, right? And sometimes the patient will develop proptosis with chemosis. Why this occurs? This occurs generally because, understand this, it will spread from your sinus to orbit. So when it is spread from sinus to orbit, you will see proptosis and chemosis. Lastly, understand this patient can also develop a bilateral proptosis. Initially, this will be unilateral proptosis. Then ultimately, it can convert into bilateral proptosis because of hematogenous or contiguous spread of this infection. So you'll see bilateral proptosis with chemosis. And patient can develop vision loss and ophthalmoplegia. Vision loss and ophthalmoplegia. If you see these signs which I have written here, these signs that bilateral proptosis, chemosis, vision loss, these signs are suggestive that now this patient is having a thrombosis in your, it is involving your cavernous sinus. So these signs are suggestive of cavernous sinus thrombosis. Cavernous sinus thrombosis. So this is the most common variant that you see. So I told you the patient will start with the normal eye pain, right? But ultimately you will see the patient, it will complain. It will go to both eyes and you will see bilateral proptosis and chemosis. You will see bilateral proptosis and chemosis. So this type of mucormycosis is most common, and generally this is what we are seeing in COVID patients. So what we see, you will see COVID patient can develop any type, but this is the case which I got. This is the case which we are getting. So understand is this. If I see, this will pass to certain phases. So there are certain phases of rhinocerebral mucormycosis. So let me tell you what are these phases. Initially, if you look at the patient, initial phase, you will see there will be a normal. So we call this initial phase. On inspection, the patient will be absolutely normal. So in initial phase, patient will be absolutely normal. So on inspection, it will be absolutely normal. If you see, like after a few days or few weeks, you will see the next phase. We call this erythematous phase. You will see erythematous phase. In this erythematous phase, you will see there may be edema present. So there may be edema. So there will be erythematous phase with or without edema. So patient can develop with edema or it can be without edema. This phase, after a few weeks or few days, this stage will be followed by a violaceous rash. We call this a violaceous appearance. And ultimately, in the end, you will see a black discoloration of that particular area. That is called a black necrotic discharge. You will see a black necrotic discharge. So these are four phases you will see generally in the patient. Initial phase, which is absolutely normal. It's a erythematous phase, violaceous appearance, and black necrotic discharge. Right. So understand this. This infection sometime can spread from your sinuses. It can extend to your palate or mouth. Right. So infection, remember, it can extend to mouth. So whenever this infection is extending to mouth, you will see a necrotic ulcer in the heart palate. You will see necrotic ulcer in heart palate. So let's try to understand this. If I say like what is the duration of the spread, it is completely rate of progression. That is, the infection rate is variable. It varies from patient to patient. Maybe it's a possibility in one patient it can spread in few days, or in another patient it can spread in few weeks. In some patient it can spread after a few years. So understand this, what thing, the take home, the note message which I'm writing here, that is rate of progression. A rate of progression of disease is always variable. Rate of progression of this disease is always variable. So this is about your rhinocerebral mucormycosis. Coming to the second entity which I am discussing now, the second entity will be, we call this a pulmonary mucormycosis. Pulmonary mucormycosis. So understand this, in this condition, what you'll notice, this is second most common variant, as I told you before. So here the patient will complain of dyspnea. So patient will have dyspnea, like all COVID patients are having. There will be cough. Sometime that some patient will complain of chest pain. There will be hemoptysis. And sometime the patient will complain that, doc, I'm having a black color sputum. So sometime there will be a black sputum. Because this is having angio invasion, so you will see it can invade through blood vessels. So you will see black sputum, and sometimes like tuberculosis or any other granulomatous disease, you will see here cavitation. You will see cavity formation or cavitation, and you will see here necrosis. So this will be like any other granulomatous inflammation, you will see the same thing. Any other fungal infection or any other granulomatous inflammation like TB, you will see the necrosis here. Now understand this, if you look at the lung, you will see a lobar consolidation. Sometimes you will see an isolated mass. So there is a possibility in the X-ray, you can see a lobar consolidation or a mass, or sometimes you can see a nodular appearance. So this will have variable presentation in X-ray. You can see a lobar consolidation. So just I'm writing these X-ray finding or CT finding. CT is a good method. So you will see this finding in a better fashion in CT. You can see a lobar consolidation or a mass, or sometimes you will see cavity. And in rare cases, you can see a wedge-shaped ischemia. So these are the findings, right? To understand this, these are the findings you can see in the CT chest, or you can see in the X-ray CT, you can see this finding in a better way, in a better fashion, more clear. They are more clear in the CT scan, right? So understand this, similar findings you can also see in aspergillosis. So understand this, the differential diagnosis of this disease will be aspergillosis, because that is also a fungal infection. Differential diagnosis will become aspergillosis. Then how we can differentiate? The best way is we can do the culture, or we can take the biopsy. So understand this, by culture biopsy, but understand this, clinically or by radiologically, what we can do is, if there are more than 10 nodules, or it is associated with pleural effusion. So understand this, you will send the X-ray for reporting to radiologist, or a CT report to radiologist. If you see more than 10 small nodules with pleural effusion, and along with patient is having a concomitant sinusitis. So understand this, these three are the points which are suggestive of mucormycosis. See, once again, more than 10 nodules, pleural effusion, and concomitant sinusitis. Right? Understand this? Why we need to keep this in mind? Because treatment for both are different. So understand this, treatment for both are different. For example, if I say for aspergillosis, we give voriconazole. In aspergillosis, we give voriconazole, but voriconazole is a risk factor for mucormycosis. That is why it is important to differentiate this from aspergillosis. Very important line. Okay, coming to the third type, that is called as cutaneous variant. Or cutaneous mucormycosis. So third type, if I say, we call this a cutaneous mucormycosis. So understand this, what you will see, it can occur due to external implantation or inoculation of fungus, right? So initially this will involve your skin. Then with skin, it may extend to your muscles. It may go to your fascia. And ultimately, it can involve your bones. Right? So understand this. If it is limited to skin and muscles, it will have a good prognosis. So I repeat my statement. If it is limited to skin and muscles, it will have a good prognosis. Means it will heal early. Right? If you try to treat this early, this will be having a good prognosis. But if it involves fascia, so this will be, we call this a necrotizing fasciitis. It can cause a necrotizing fasciitis. Right? In this case, you will see the mortality will reach up to 80%. So this will have 80% mortality. And ultimately, if it's affecting bone, then mortality becomes even more. So understand this, if it is limited to skin and muscle, it will have a good prognosis. But if it extends beyond this, it can lead to necrotizing fasciitis, or it can affect your bones, that the mortality in that case will increase. Okay, the fourth variant in my list, that will be the fourth type of mucormycosis. If I say, that will be your GIT mucormycosis. So if I say GIT mucormycosis, understand this. So this was seen previously in past in neonates, right? And it was generally associated with disseminated disease, right? Now understand this, but now these cases are increasing in adults, in elderly, especially in neutropenic patients. So understand this. So GIT mucormycosis, it was previously noted in neonates only, right? Neonates with premature births. But now you will see cases are noted. Cases are also seen there. Cases are seen in adults and elderly, especially those who are immunocompromised. Those who are immunocompromised or having neutropenia or having a prolonged steroid use or having a prolonged steroid use. How this will present, the patient will present to you with abdominal pain. Patient will have abdominal pain. Sometime there will be abdominal distension. There will be abdominal pain as well as abdominal distension. If I say furthermore, what you'll see, the patient can develop nausea and vomiting. So I'm just writing in short, it is NND means nausea and vomiting. And some cases have been reported that they cause a GI bleed. So GI bleed can be in the form of hematemesis or sometime it can be in the form of melena. As such, there is less hematochezia, but it is a delayed bleed. So you will see either hematemesis or melena. So this is a GI type. Okay, coming to the next type, what we call this? We call this a disseminated disease. Or disseminated mucormycosis. So understand this. This is disseminated means it is spreading everywhere. So if I say the most common site for dissemination, the most common site will be your brain. Most common site for dissemination is brain. And this is having over 90% mortality. It is having more than 90% mortality. So this is the most severe type of mucormycosis. Coming to the last type, then we'll move forward to the diagnostic and treatment of this condition. Then the last form is a miscellaneous form. A miscellaneous type. So understand this in a miscellaneous type. So it can occur at any place. It can occur at any place means. So it can go to any place. It can go to your kidney. It can go to your mediastinum, your trachea, anywhere. So it can go to anywhere. So it can involve or it can spread to any other site. Like it can go to kidney, trachea, mediastinum. Okay. Lastly, so I told you the different types of this. So how to make a diagnosis? So understand this, how you are diagnosing this condition. So for making a diagnosis, what we need? So understand this, we have different methods. So what we can do, initially the patient, then initial test, what we can do is we can do a CBC. So if I say the workup of this patient, in the CBC, you may see neutropenia. There's a possibility you may see neutropenia. Second finding you will see, the test that we recommend in this patient will be an X-ray chest. So in the X-ray chest, you can see some nodules, but these are generally smaller. So we recommend doing a CT chest or an MRI. Right? So understand this. So we can do a CT in case of pulmonary or an MRI. So understand this. The point is, it's a expensive disease, so you have to do your investigation with keeping in mind the patient pocket. So initially, if we think of rhinocerebral mucormycosis, then we'll do a CT head with sinuses or MRI head. If you are suspecting pulmonary, then we do a CT chest. So CT chest or MRI chest, or what we can do, a CT head or MRI head right? So understand this. The fourth investigation that we can do in this patient will be biopsy. You will take the biopsy of that particular sample and histopathological finding. So biopsy with histopathological findings. So understand this. So this is a sensitive as well as specific test for this. So you will see, a wide, thick-walled, ribbon-like, aseptate hyphae, right? Which are branching at a right angle, which will branch at right angle, right? So by this histopathological finding, you will stain this with stain. The name of the stain, if I write the stain, that stain we use is PAS, periodic acid shift stain. Or we can use hematoxylin and eosin stain, H and E stain. So these are the stain that we use. So understand this, these biopsy with stain will tell you that, it will tell that it is a mucorrheal. It is a mucorrheal means it is a mucor infection. But it will not tell you the exact species. So to know about exact species, the best test will remind the culture. So culture we do, understand this, culture will do to know species. So to know the species of means which mucor or which rhizopus is causing the disease, for that, in that case, you have to do the culture. So culture take around 2 to 4 days. Right? And remember, the one important drawback of this culture is, understand this, culture is positive only in 50% of patients. Only in 50% of patients, you will see culture is positive. In another 50%, you will see culture may be negative. So these are the investigations you will do. So once you will make a diagnosis, now you will start treating the patient. You will start treating the patient. So understand this. What could be a differential diagnosis? So just I am explaining this. It can be due to other differential diagnosis of this condition, will be aspergillosis or any other fungal infection. It can also be a sinusitis due to bacterial cause like Klebsiella or Streptococcus, Staphylococcus. So these are the differential diagnosis. Just I am writing here the differential diagnosis of this condition. The first is aspergillosis. Aspergillosis. Second differential in my list, it will be again a fungal infection. We call this fusariosis, which is a rare infection, right? Then we have some rare fungi that is, we call this Demetiaceous fungi. These are rare soil-borne fungus, Demetiaceous fungi. If I see the other differential in my list, that will be sinusitis due to Staph aureus or Streptococcus or Klebsiella. Especially Klebsiella rhinoscleromatis. A fifth differential is a syndrome, a rare syndrome that will have same picture, that is Tolosa-Hunt syndrome. But understand this mucor mycosis, it keep on progressing. It keep on progressing every day. Or this Tolosa-Hunt syndrome, it will not have that progression. It will not progress. So coming to the treatment, how you will treat this patient, so understand this. The treatment is, you should start. Treatment is based on three important factors. That first will be early initiation of therapy. So first is early initiation, means you have to treat early. So initiate early. The second point, consider in mind, that second point will be, you should reverse the predisposing factors. So understand this. The second will be a rapid reversal of predisposing factor. Rapid reversal of predisposing factor. And third will be surgical debridement. Now understand this, why the surgical debridement is needed. In any case, you are having a necrotic tissue or a necrotic area. So when you give antifungal drugs, they will not penetrate that necrotic area. Right, so we have to remove that area, only then the antifungal permeability you can increase. So these are the three important steps that you need to consider in your mind. Now understand this, how to start, what are the steps you need to follow. So the step number one is, whenever you see the clinical, if you see the clinical suspicious, so based on your practice, if there is any clinical suspicious of this infection, what is important, empirical treatment should be started. So don't wait for culture report to come or histopathology report to come. Empirical treatment should be started, right? This empirical treatment should be started. We start this by liposomal amphotericin B. So this time writing LAMB. LAMB means liposomal amphotericin B. Liposomal amphotericin B. Now understand this. Don't wait for the diagnosis, start the treatment. So we have different alternative of this therapy also. So if I see the first line treatment, so we have three first line drugs, just I'm mentioning here. The first and the most common used drug that is having a less side effect, that is your LAMB. liposomated amphotericin B. In short, we call this LAM. Second drug that we can use nothing, that is be a lipid based complex of amphotericin B. We call this amphotericin B lipid complex, ABLC. A third will be a normal amphotericin B, that is called as amphotericin B deoxycholate. So these are three first line drugs available. So understand this, liposomated amphotericin B, amphotericin B lipid complex, and amphotericin B deoxycholate. So let me discuss them one by one. So this is the preferred, most preferred drug. So if I say this is most preferred, because deoxycholate one is highly nephrotoxic, this is most preferred. So this we start at a dose of 5 mg per kg. We start at a dose of 5 mg per kg once a day. 5 mg per kg once a day. If you think that it is having a CNS involvement, if you think, then you can increase the dose from 7.5 mg to 10 mg once a day. So understand this. If you suspect that it could be involving your brain, CNS involvement, then you can increase the dose to 7.5 mg to 10 mg once a day. So initially, you remember the initial dose will be 5 mg per kg. 5 mg per kg. If I talk about this amphotericin B lipid complex molecule, understand this. This dose, you will see this in a dose of 5 mg per kg. 5 mg per kg. Or we can give a deoxycholate form. Deoxycholate form, it is 1 to 1.5 mg per kg. So all these drugs are given once a day. So understand this, you can use any of these two drugs. So these two drugs, because whenever like in COVID, we are having a new drugs, that drug become out of stock, and a new disease on a new entity. So nowadays, like, you are seeing a shortage of liposomated amphotericin B. So in that case, we can use ABLC is the next thing that we can use in the patient. So understand this, what is next is this side effect of this normal deoxycholate form of amphotericin B. It is a highly nephrotoxic drug. Understand this? And this will have, it's having a drawback of this drug. It's not a side effect, but a drawback which I'm writing here. The drawback of this drug will be, it is having a poor CNS penetration. Right. So understand this. After this, if I can say the next drug, which I can start in the patient, next group of drug. So we have started this drug. So if I say the next group or alternative or second line therapy, suppose you are giving these drugs to the patient, there is no response. Then what we can start other drugs. These are azoles type of group of drugs. So we have a drug called Isavuconazole and Posaconazole. Let me quickly say, so this which I discussed, the first line, these are the group of drugs. We call them polyenes. These are polyenes group of antifungals. And if I say, then we can switch to, if there's no improvement, then we can switch to azoles. These are azoles, isavuconazole or posaconazole. So understand this, isavuconazole, how we give this isavuconazole, we give 200 milligram TDS, right? First day you will get TDS, then it is followed by, this will be followed by 200 milligram once a day. So understand this, you will give a 200 milligram of this drug, TDS first day, followed by 200 milligram once a day. So like in some places you will see that tablet of 200 milligram is not available. In that case, what we give 300 milligram. Is it clear? So understand this. Next is posaconazole. If I say the posaconazole, so like this dose is very variable. So if I say the posaconazole, we start with this drug. This is given 200 milligram. This will be given 4 times a day. But again, the same thing. It is not available, like especially in our country. In our country, it's available in a 300 milligram dose. So initially, what we do, 300 mg. Either we can give 200 mg today. All 300 mg BD. This is the dose that we give for first day. First day, right? Followed by 200 to 300 mg OD, means once a day. So understand this. I have told you that is dose of isavuconazole and posaconazole. Isavuconazole and posaconazole. There is no role of combining these two drugs. So like all the clinical trials can combine these two drugs like polyenes. So just I'm writing this line. If you combine polyenes means amphotericin with azoles. So, no, it is not effective than individual polyenes. It is not effective than individual polyenes. Like sometimes they ask me a question like, for how long duration we will give these drugs? Understand this, if I say in case of these drugs, polyenes, ideally we give these drugs till patient is having resolving of symptoms. Till patient is having resolving of symptoms. So generally the patient will resolve in 2 to 3 weeks. So understand this, we can give these drugs for 14 days to 21 days. If I say these drugs, isavuconazole, posaconazole, these also the drugs, the same things, we give till there is resolution of symptom. Till there is resolution of symptoms, some doctors recommend this for using this for 1 month and in fact more than a month. So my point is, you will continue these drugs till there is, so I am writing here, drugs are continued. So if I say polyenes means your amphotericin B, they are continued till resolution of symptoms, right? So understand this. So initially what we give, we give these drugs daily. Antifungal drugs, which I told you, these antifungal drugs, initially what we give them daily. So followed by, and understand this. So initially how we taper this, initially we give daily. Initially they are given daily. Then it is followed by thrice weekly, or you can say alternate day. Then you will give them alternate day. And ultimately you will give them twice weekly. So they are also stopped slowly, twice weekly, right? And duration, I can say it is till resolution of symptoms, or symptoms generally they will resolve in 14 to 21 days, right? And I told you, like generally most of the patients they recover on polyenes, so we don't have to add them azoles. If you are adding azoles, or you are replacing, if patient is resistant to this, there is no point of adding azoles. In case the patient is resistant to polyenes, then what we can do, we can give azoles. Now understand this, there are certain points that you should keep in mind. So these are the take home message which I am writing, some starred highlighted point that is important. First is any patient of mucormycosis. So this will be the main line of this lecture that you should attend. This is the main important impact. So which studied from different books, different articles. So understand this. First is, you should avoid unnecessary use of iron tablets or iron syrup or iron supplements. Avoid iron or unnecessary blood transfusion. So for example, a patient is having hemoglobin level of 8.58. Avoid blood transfusion in these cases. Avoid unnecessary use of iron or free iron. Right. Second is, there should be a rapid and aggressive correction of blood sugar. Second, there will be a rapid correction of blood sugar. So most of the patient, it is seen that early you correct the blood sugar, they will respond early. The third point that you should keep in mind is, a person who is on steroid, you should taper the dose. Start tapering the steroid. Right? Now understand this, suppose like in trials, many trials, it is seen that if you add bicarbonate, if patient is acidotic, suppose if patient came to you with diabetic ketoacidosis, if you add bicarbonate, there will be early recovery with mucormycosis and early recovery with acidosis. So adding bicarbonate in diabetic ketoacidosis patient is beneficial, right? If person is taking any kind of immunosuppressant, either you can stop them or you can reduce the dose. Any kind of immunosuppressant, if patient is taking, either you can stop them or you can reduce the dose, right? And last important thing is you should always consult a surgeon and take his opinion for debridement, because I told you before, like, if you debride the necrotic tissue, what will happen? It will increase the permeability or penetration power of these antifungal drugs, right? A last point is, understand this, whenever you are giving a normal version of amphotericin B, so your patient should be having adequate hydration. The patient should have an adequate hydration. Adequate hydration means, before giving amphotericin B, what we can do is we can give him a 500 ml of NS 2 hours before injection. So before injection of amphotericin B, you can give a 500 ml bolus of normal saline, right? And if possible, you can add a 1 ampule of KCL. Why? Because if you do this, you can prevent. If we do this, what we can do? We can prevent hypokalemia and nephrotoxicity that can occur due to amphotericin B. Last line is the amphotericin B. Generally, how we give this? We give in a 5% dextrose solution. For giving this injection amphotericin B, what we do? We give 5% dextrose. So you will dilute. In 5% dextrose. So there are possibilities, some more treatment, but their efficacy is still uncertain. Like, we can use a recombinant neutrophil increasing substance. So we can use recombinant cytokines. We can use transfusion of GM-CSF or GCSF that will increase your neutrophils. Or we can do hyperbaric oxygen. So these kind of things have been tried, but they are not having a better result. So these are still under trials. Lastly, if I say, you can see the patient, how this will present. So let me show you some of the images so that you can get an idea about this. So you can see, like, image one, which I'm having, you can see this. You can see a person who is having a cutaneous mucormycosis in the leg. So this is a person who is having a cutaneous mucormycosis of leg. You can see a black necrotic star, a completely black. This is a dead tissue, necrotic tissue. In second, you can see this patient who is having a ptosis. There is a ptosis with erythematous skin. You can see the ptosis here. You can see the drooping of eyelid here. There will be a ptosis with an erythema. This will be the erythematous skin. So you will see the erythema. In this case, if I see in this third image, you will see the patient is having some sort of edema here. If I zoom this, you can see the palpable edema. This will be a palpable edema with proptosis. So probably this patient is having a cavernous sinus thrombosis. And you can see this is now involving your palate. So there can be palatal necrosis. It can lead to necrosis of palate. So there can be, I told you, this can involve, from sinus, it can extend to your mouth, oral cavity. It can lead to palatal necrosis. If I see, you can see this is a baby. This baby is having a severe rhinocerebral mucormycosis. This is a severe rhinocerebral mucormycosis. So from nose, it invades to your brain. Rhinocerebral mucormycosis. In this, you can see this is like cutaneous form. Again, it is having a cutaneous involvement. Right, and possibly it is also having simultaneously like dissemination here in the periorbital area. So you can see this is the black star. This is like how it look in the skin. You can see this is the black star. Okay, if I say the CT findings, so you can see the first, you will see the first, there are different type of pattern in the CT that we can get in case of this patient. So you can see this first finding, which I'm having, we call this a halo sign. This first find, you will see, we call this a halo sign. You can see a halo sign a ground glass opacity, a ring of ground glass opacity, you will see we call this halocyanin, right? If you see here, this is what we call this. We call this a reverse halocyanin. This is your reverse halocyanin. Halocyanin and reverse halocyanin. So understand this, these are the findings these you are seeing in a CT scan. If you see in the MRI, you will see the hypodensity in the MRI. This will be an MRI image. So you can see in MRI hypodensity. And if I notice this, you can see this is a CT angiography. In CT angiogram, you will see vascular occlusion. You will see vascular occlusion due to mucormycosis, right? If I say like this, you can see this is your, again, a halocyanin. This halocyanin, you can see in the patient, this is day 1, day 8, and day 15, this halocyanin, it is increasing and patient condition is deteriorating. So from onwards, you will see progression of disease. You will see a progression of disease. Okay, now understand this. You can see here. You can see this is your hyphae. You can see these are 6 to 16 micrometer wide hyphae. These are 6 to 16 micrometer wide hyphae, ribbon-like. Probably this is a wide hyphae. So this question also came in exam when I was preparing for NEET PG. It is like 6 to 16. You can see 6 to 16 micrometer wide hyphae, a ribbon-like. Ribbon like 5 feet. If you see, you can see in hematoxylin staining. You will see they are covered with eosinophilic halo. This phenomena, we call this Splendor Hopley phenomena. Splendor Hopley phenomena. Splendor Hopley phenomena, understand this. What happened in this, you will see this neutrophils, they are covered by a neutrophilic halo. You will see the neutrophilic halo here, they are covered by a neutrophilic halo. We call this Splendor Hopley phenomena. If I compare this, you can see, this is the hyphae of Aspergillus. This is the hyphae of Aspergillus. This is the Aspergillus hyphae. How we make the difference? Understand this. The 6 to 16 micrometer. Here you will see these are just a 3 to 5 micrometer. These are just a 3 to 5 micrometer. These are 3 to 5 micrometer. So then you can see this is again an aspergillosis. And here you can see a mucormycosis which is branched at right angle. Mucormycosis which is branched at right angle. So these are some image based things that you can get an idea. So just for our this purpose of this making video is to tell you how to make an early diagnosis of disease. The point is, don't wait for the test report to come. In a simple line is, start early treatment. And these are the few important points that I told you that you should keep in mind before treating this condition. So I know this video is a bit lengthy, and it is actually, I made this video for physicians, those who are practicing. So this video is for physicians, those who are practicing. You can get some questions from this by, because it's a burning topic, hot topic. Hot topic means COVID is always a hot topic. So, and there are some misleading information in the Facebook and YouTube and WhatsApp group about this topic. So I thought to tell you about this topic. So this is the treatment management plan of this topic. I hope you like the video. So this is about, so I started a COVID series in my YouTube channel. So you can follow this COVID series to get more updates on this COVID treatment and management. So thank you so much. Thank you for your attention. See you in the next video. Good luck.